How y'all doing? I want to welcome y'all to Strawberry Space, where we discuss transgender relations.
We make how many eggs a month, miss? Oh, you're trans. Well, fuck, did I pick the wrong person to ask? That is hilarious. And let me tell you something, you fooled me. I mean, you're good. Is that your boyfriend? Or, bro, he is the most Poindexter, square-looking guy. And I, for the whole time, I was like, how did he get this fine-ass Latina, bro? What the fuck is going on over here? Bro, he brought you front row, or you brought him? That's what the fuck I'm talking about. She's like, everybody on YouTube gonna know who you are. Bro, his whole family in Chevy Chase is like, what the fuck is going on? This is incredible. There's no way. When did you transition? It must have been early. Last year? I mean, she's fucking kinda hot, dude. This... Not saying you can't be, but you know, sometimes, you know. Did you know or you just found out right now? He's like...
Hey, Strawberry Space. Okay, girl, now we have some interesting news today. MTV Guy Co's Andrew Schultz is now going on his comedic tour, and you just saw Strawberry Space Transgender Men and Women. He had really picked on, you know, the trans women in the audience, but it almost seemed like as if he liked her. I'm sorry if I have an echo. I'm in a big, large room. I'm trying to actually expand this YouTube channel. The transgender tea that we're giving you today is it, you know, taboo for trans women to now be in relationships? He took her front row, girl. And this now means that since he was on MTV trying to coach other young men and mentor them with cisgender women how to navigate, how to date, and really how to deal with, you know, women before, like, the red pill, blue pill culture on TikTok. What does this mean? Does this mean for the trans community now finally a win? Because, you know, when men are in their prime, like in their early 20s, they'll deal with cis women. And now that they're drained and burnt out and just sexually frustrated and furious, now they're going to consider trans women in their 40s? Because he's never... really talk like this or really had, you know, a positive reaction towards trans women this far. And I'm glad he didn't do the Dave Chappelle route. I'm glad he did not really come and say like, hey, you know, that's a man. But, you know, like I said, Strawberry Space, they will never say you're men in front of your man. So I'm just glad that she was courted. I'm glad she was respected and properly identified. Okay, girl, so we're moving on. And it's some ballroom tea. So for the DMV, we have so many icons in the LGBT community when it comes to ballroom. So on Facebook, Lucille May has said that in a big long statement, she does not care about being deemed icon. So really her name, her nickname for short is Lucy Papers. Lucy Papers says you can't go to any icon and say that I was deemed an icon or that I'm pressed to be deemed an icon. And it's a lot going on in the ballroom community with transgender tea, Strawberry Space, because there was an Oakland ball over in California, right? And people are pressed because Pink Ebony had got stabbed along with his father by Corey Gorgeous Gucci, and he got banned for, I think, about a year. And so, you know, now they're trying to unban him because he has the coin. So it's really kind of like in everyone else's mind, okay, after seeing Lucy's Facebook post, they're like, hey, like with these icons and with these trans women and with these bush queens, like, why are you... not an icon? And also, why are you unbanning Corey? Like, what is your thing with him? Why can't he be permanently banned? Now, mind you, Strawberry Space, trans men and women. He stabbed this boy, which was a butch and drag, called him a hard bitch. And, you know, really fucked up his face. He didn't get any criminal charges for it, and I just don't feel like that was right. So I'm speeding along because y'all said I'd take long with this, but Cisgender Men and Women Ballroom is supposed to be an LGBT event to bring unity. I know the only thing y'all probably can use to the equivalency to this. So how many of y'all know that show Back in the Day Pose? That's really what this really kind of is mimicking. So me personally, I feel like, okay, you know, there should be, whether he funds or not, no type of leniency or slap on the wrist towards Corey. I think also Pink Ebony's father, you know, got stabbed as well by a trans woman and Corey. So this speaks a lot for the gorgeous Gucci camp. I know that Kelly is the house mother. It's a lot, you know, going on with that. But, you know, you really have to kind of be careful when it comes to who you associate with and who you know, who you're affiliated with. I know a lot of people was trying to come for Pink. I know Pink also claimed on Bree Star, which is Fairy Puss's Bigo screen recording live on YouTube, that, you know, he also lost his father. So he's just been going through a lot mentally and emotionally. I don't feel like Pink should have ever gotten banned. I don't understand what he did wrong. You know, Deshaun from Legendary said that he was also in attendance inside the ball, but he didn't know what happened outside the ball. I feel like that's cap. And I feel like, you know, a lot of people are trying to save face for the house. It's a lot going on. Me personally, I'm not in ballroom because I feel like it just perpetuates this hierarchy system. And really, the priorities are fucked up. I feel like a lot of people spend all this money on the costumes and effects and just walking. And then when it comes to your credit score, you know, what you drive, where you live and where you work, if you work, stuff just isn't in place and together. And I just feel like that's more telling. And you use your status of, you know, legend, of icon, of pioneer to kind of have like seniority over somebody. Like, bitch, I'm better than you. But in reality, like, you know, outside of this event, bitch, you're nobody. Like, come on, let's keep it a buck. Let's keep it a stack. I mean, I'm trying to keep it cute, but it's just like, you know, you can't walk around these gowns in public. And I just feel like there's a reality realness, and then, you know, that's coming up into the world to blend, and what's being stealth and your 9-to-5 and the blue collar jobs. And then there's a ballroom realness that's like, okay, you know, tends across the board. And I just feel like that's just ain't it enough for, you know, us just being at each other in the trans community. I know a lot of people say like it's just friendly competition, but me personally, I don't see ballroom bringing people together. I actually see a lot of times, even in the Kiki scene, where it just promotes so much violence. I mean, it's good, you know, but I'm just saying, you got fights 1 minute, the boy got stabbed the next. I think at one ball, somebody got maced. It's just so much going on. And, you know, I just don't see the unity. So just keep it to Facebook. We have South Carolina trans activist Sunshine Bella Goodman. Sunshine is a girl who came in, and she really advocates for a lot of the trans community in South Carolina. I believe she also does like fundraisers, you know, rallies and speeches, and she really, you know, uses her voice for like a positive, you know, role model and just the epitome of what a woman should be. Now, this is an example of what trans women should be doing as opposed to ballroom. I know she was at the LA Black Queer Summit, and she's just making her mark. So she made a statement on Facebook regarding the Grammys. Now, you know, Strawberry Space, we just talk about the transgender tea here, girl. When I talk about like Nelly and Ashanti being pregnant or Cat Williams, but she made a statement when it became to Beyonce being snubbed, saying that she side-eyed Fantasia when she gave her Tina Turner tribute. And she was like, bitch, y'all can fight me or whatever, but I said what I said. So I didn't see the Grammys, but I wonder who else agrees with this. Like, should she just stick to singing Patti LaBelle songs, or, you know, was Fantasia worthy of, you know, the actual tribute? She actually has a GoFundMe for her gender affirming surgery. One thing I don't understand about a lot of these trans women that are in positions of power, that have all this influence and impact and money, I just be wondering, like, okay, one, do they work, like, outside of being an entrepreneur? Like, do they know about the resources that we are given on the lower level? Because it seems like a lot of us are getting, you know, Medicaid-based gender-affirming surgeries, and it's kind of like we're just going, getting in it through our, you know, doctors, and they who, the bigger name, the bigger money, the bigger, you know, all of that with just their influence, they're just, oh, let me see if I can pay for this out of pocket, or let me see if y'all can donate to this and this. And it's just like, why don't you just do what everyone else is doing? Like, why do we have to, out of our pocket, pay for what something that, you know, your counterparts are getting for free? Like, you don't know the sauce, sis. You don't know the juice. Like, you are all these trans women, and, you know, I just hate when people kind of like gatekeep surgeries and doctors and, you know, what they're doing. It just kind of, I don't know, it just seems like, you know, to have somebody, you know, up there, and I would consider her up there with like the Dominique Morgans and Hope Giselles, it's like, you know, what's not being told to the generation before us? And it's almost like, I feel like that's like the borderline femme queen, like the 70s and 80s kind of trans woman, and then the trans women in like the 90s is more so like we just open with it, and then now you have the 2000s, which they considered the dolls. So, you know, it's just kind of, it's interesting how a lot of people can just have that, you know, information either available for them or not. And it's just like, you know, even Nova, she has a GoFundMe, and I'm just like, and it'd be like LA, it'd be like Atlanta, it'd be like, you know, the most powerful of the trans women that are in these rooms that you would just die to get into. But it's just like, okay, sis, what's tea? Like, you don't know to just go here and there and then get the letters and then get all this and that. And it's just like, it's just, I don't know. The content creators, it just seems like they're not coming down to earth with us regular folk
here in South Carolina. And today I want to give a message of love and support to all of the trans youth out there, not just in South Carolina, but in the whole United States. I like to call you all my nieces and nephews. Yes, nieces and nephews. So I want you all to know that I know, and we all know, that it is not easy always, but I hope that you know through this event and through this, all the support that we've had from folks throughout this year, that you are loved, you are supported, and there is a whole wide world waiting just for you. Thank you.
Together, bitch, I have no preference. I prefer personally a trans man. That's who I feel like I am meant to be with. I'm meant to be with a trans man. But who knows? I might end up sharing makeup with a bitch or having to beat up a nigga every now and then.
I hate the burden of having to talk about my transness on the first or even the second date.
Wow. You would let me take you out twice.
Well, this is ideal.
Say, right, and not say, just so you know,
if we met out and about, yeah, I'm more likely to hold off longer. Now, online, if I'm like on an app or something, I put it in my profiles. Like, I don't play that game.
No, but if I met you at a bar, restaurant, whatever, Raquel, so beautiful, can I take you out? Sure.
It varies, but I'm not going to be like, can you take me out? Sure. Oh, by the way, I'm trans. Like, I might do that, but I don't feel obligated to do that all the time.
It's interesting that you say you don't feel obligated.
I hate the burden of having to talk about my transness.
Hey y'all, I'm Raquel. I'm the girl in the video who was in conversation with Toure. Look for the full episode wherever you get your podcast, and I think the video is coming out in a few days. I just wanted to clarify because it's some comments coming at me sideways on Instagram and on TikTok about what I was saying, and I just want to add more context. There's also more context in the full interview, so I urge you to listen. We have this dynamic where trans women are expected to carry our identities on our sleeves, despite not really living in a society where y'all make it safe for us to be our full selves, right? So yeah, it'd be great if I encountered overwhelmingly men who knew that there was a chance that they were encountering a trans woman, right? But that is just not the society that we live in. And so there's a lot of nuance here. And I think cis folks don't understand that y'all aren't really in a position to give us guidance on how we navigate dating and desire and all of these different things, because y'all have no idea. You only know your slice of life, which is not the exact same as ours. And we have never contended that you would have the range to understand those things. So with that, I will say, I think some people are tripped up over what I was saying about being open, sharing my transness and profiles on dating apps and what that's like versus if a guy hits on me in real life. On a dating app, me putting that I'm trans in a profile is a screener, really, for me, so that I'm not wasting my time dealing with men who are not evolved enough to understand their attraction to me. But let's be clear, plenty of men don't read profiles. They just see the photos, they like the photo, give you all the compliments. I've had plenty of times where guys I've talked to for a few hours or maybe even a day or two didn't know that I was trans until later when they went back to my profile, and then that was a waste of time. Or I've even had times where we were on a date and then they didn't know until after the date when they went back to look at my profile and learn more. So that's a thing. I think in real life, all women in general who date particularly cishet men are at risk of violence, especially if we reject someone, right? And so I'm often using a different number than the one that I typically use to put some distance between my, like, real life and number and everything and them. But I also think that y'all aren't often accounting for the fact that a guy might just be violent and ugly towards me just because I've burst his bubble and he's realized that, oh, he's hit on a trans woman. Like, that could be enough to set him off. So I say that to say that there's risk at varying levels of engagement with a random guy. With the date thing, it is just unfortunate that I think there's a lot of ignorance, of course, about the trans experience. And so many of the guys that I've dated, I've been the first trans woman that they've engaged or said that they did, right? And so I'm often the first, right? Which means that I'm often having to take a risk to see where a guy is or whatever. So that's a thing. I do want to say that I wish that we could have more nuanced discussions about this without ugly comments like, well, this is why y'all end up dead now and y'all are deceiving folks. It's not deception. You are owed my identity, right? And look, if you only want to engage with cisgender women, then put that burden on you. But I think the last thing I want to share is that it's a problem that the focus is so much on trans women to share our identities versus us creating a culture and a community and a society where we are safe enough to just be ourselves in whatever space and in whatever scenario, right? Without the risk of violence. The problem isn't really that we're trans. The problem is that we allow cis men to react in all kinds of ways and then justify it and explain it away. And that's not okay. So I know that's throwing a lot. If you have any more conversation points or comments or questions, drop them below. But I just wanted to air a little bit more nuance into this conversation because the range is not there in the comments, honey. But rarely is it. Anyway, bye.
Yeah, on a possible attack.
Whoa. The HRT. That's the best of the best.
The best. It is all for you. Girl, my bad, I just can't help it. Girl, you taste so good. Loving feels so numb. Ride me till I'm about to. Oh, baby.
All right, so Strawberry Space, wasn't that a TikTok medley treat? Ooh, yes, that trans man singer was scrumptious. So with Raquel really doing her thing, I'm so glad they have a trans woman who is so articulate and so well-spoken. Some more TikTok tea when it comes to transgender relationships. Pink Princess got in a relationship. Yeah, she thought she was slick doing a little TikTok post and delete. Her and her little hubby had went live on Facebook. So I had asked her, you know, did she get married? And she did confirm. So they did go to the courthouse. And I said, yes, I'm glad that, you know, it was a transgender love in a positive way. And, you know, she supported him. He supported her. They just went to the courthouse and did something, you know, small and intimate and just, you know, very quickly. And it was like, you know, the definition of if he wanted to, he would. And I'm just glad that, you know, it gives me hope for the trans community, you know, in addition to that. Moving on, you know, and some more TikTok tea. Can we just have a moment of silence for, I don't know if her name is SoCal, like for Southern California Barbie or Social Barbie, but Barbie is really doing her thing. From Zeus to Now That's TV, she really is becoming the it girl when it comes to the LGBT community. It's almost like, you know, though activism is imperative, you almost have to do reality TV to get your exposure out there and to greater your reach and broaden, you know, like just representation for the LGBT community. That's so, I know for the, I haven't seen her in Mean Girls. I just seen Pressure. But as for the South Central Baddies reunion season 4, she was there alongside Kinsey, orchestrating everything, being a correspondent, you know, like a spokesperson. And she just was really doing her thing, interviewing and, you know, even to TikTok, her being a viral sound, like, oh, okay, I was about to say, what happened? Hold up. You know, she's just, you know, becoming global. And I'm just so happy for her.
Yo, listen here. Listen, motherfucking here. Don't piss me the fuck off tonight. On my soul, don't piss me the fuck off tonight.
Oh, okay. Okay, because I thought I was going to say, what? How that?
And baby, I know y'all seen that TikTok everywhere. We might have to count Cashmere into it, but you can't deny the influence of the worldwide sound that Barbie has created. Anytime you hear on my soul, I'm God in heaven on the dead homies, you know that's Barbie. Now, if you hear, I don't give a fuck about your mama, because I be trying to imitate them too, that might be Cashmere, but anything else, baby, that's Barbie. And it actually got all the way to the group SWB because, you know, out of all three of the members, you know, Coco has the gay son, so they have like a lot of LGBT shows like Playboy on there and making the cast on Now That's TV. She actually went on Instagram, so I'm gonna have y'all listen because Coco actually watches the show and recited Barbie's line, the famous On My Soul.
I have a question for y'all. Do you have a guilty pleasure? And if so, what is it? My guilty pleasure is watching Now That's TV on my cell. On its homie. Mac, 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 Mac. Yeah. And I blame Isaiah for that because I didn't even know what that was until he started doing his reviews. And I was like, oh my God. I started watching, I paid my coin, and I am so hooked on myself. And I'm like, damn, girl, you were too old for that. I'm 53 years old, but I'm caught up. I'm all in it. I watch that thing every Sunday to see who is going to get a black eye. My son's like, you so ghetto. Yeah, honey, I'm from the Bronx. It's still in me. I've grown a little bit, but it's still in me. On my soul. On the dead homie. Yeah.
I know that's right, honey. So now segueing from that onto some Twitter tea, Heaven Lee, a famous porn star, she's like, well, I like to say porn star, Strawberry Space. So I'll say entrepreneur when it comes to like us trans girls. She's been doing her thing with FFS. She got it. And I think she's 1 month post-op. She's already back in the game, being entrepreneur, getting the dates. And, you know, she's definitely been doing her thing. I think she's healed up and she, you know, put that makeup and glam on, and I mean, she is serving it, honey. You know, doesn't she look good?
So, like, when I just made back on Dexter, I got the urge to get back in this one bag.
All right, Strawberry Space. Now, your favorite Detroit rapper is back again, Cash Doll. And made Fuck 'Em, that's a new song she got. I wasn't really feeling power, but the big controversy is, do your big one, baby, do your big one. Transgender TikTok sensation Keish, you know, the one that had the famous sound, he eating my ass, he eating my ass, he eating my ass, and the one who had the term like moo. Akasha Bentley, the one who is a singer who has the song Mad Hoes, she had a disabled Instagram. But before she got it disabled, she had a shady little post where she said that she originated the phrase, do your big one. Now, I'm not going to lie, there's a lot of people, Strawberry Space, who are on Bigo, who trans men and women, you know, we recycle phrases all the time, you know, do your big one, work your set. So I'm not really sure if I can get the Cash Doll shade and give it, you know, 100% to Miss Bentley. I would need for her, you know, to trademark that, because a Cash Doll can just trademark it. It would just have it all up to date. I don't know if Akasha was the first one who started saying that. She might have been. But I'm not like 100% sure. I really don't think Cash Doll really fools with the LGBT community anymore, because she fired her gay assistant Brody with the IG message. She actually pinned a message and the comments went crazy. I thought he actually had his account disabled, and I went on my Finsta. That's a fake Insta, Strawberry Space. But just to find out, you know, his Instagram is still up. He does still have pictures of Cash Doll up trying to accept bookings, but he put another E in there. So if you were to type his name in there, it looked like he's not there, but you know, he is still there. And they said that Brody was borrowing Cash's Birkins, stealing money from her. They said that he was just doing a lot, child. So I'm not really sure, you know, when it comes to that, like, where do we go from here, claiming that Akasha was the first to do X, Y, and Z, and, you know, just having Cash Doll's song. But, you know, since she's the bigger artist, people are going to support her. I do want to say, though, transgender men and women, Akasha has been like with one of the greats, like Suki and Sexy, and I really do hope she gets the recognition she deserves, because, you know, she's definitely been around like a lot of people, and I feel like everybody knows her on the back end, behind the scenes, but no one wants to give her the credit in front of the camera where it matters to change her life. It's just like, okay, that's just my tranny friend. Like, nobody really wants to acknowledge her, and I hope that she does kind of grow from that. Speaking of acknowledging Miss Strawberry Space, I got something really, really, really messy to tell you about me. I guess, you know, we talking about transgender men and women and the T and the LGBT community coming from this T. I want to explain to you what's going on with, you know, Gay Magazine. So Gay Magazine had a forum set in Atlanta. And a lot of me and my other news people that was interns, we couldn't go. So the journalistic integrity was at an all-time high. When it came to seeing a staff writer, we were volunteers, and I was told I could not interview Sydney Starr. So when, you know, we would come, we would just come and do our articles, and we did that for quite some time. I actually did that for 5 years. Oliver Twist had directed my first commercial for Gay Magazine in Atlanta. It was a Kickstarter. So I've been writing articles for a long time. Actually, the whole approval and denial in Slack had, you know, abrupted this YouTube channel. Because when stuff was denied, I couldn't write about it, and they were transgender topics that I felt very passionate about. So long story short, Sydney Starr was the first girl to be on Wildin' Out. And I wanted to do an interview on her, but I was denied with Gay Magazine. So they just wanted me to write another article about her. You know, so I felt like Akasha kind of, because they wanted me behind the camera, but I wanted to be in front of the camera interviewing. And I felt like though Gay Magazine was kind of catered more towards gay men, I really wanted to expand the horizon. So they had it for, you know, lesbian writers and, you know, gay men, but where was the trans, you know, representation? So when I had that happen, Strawberry Space, can you believe that I was denied that? And I said, well, social media is an exposure, you know, is this, I don't know. I felt like Strawberry Space, it just needed something to give, and I just needed some money. That's really what I'm trying to say. I'm sugarcoating around the topic, but you need to either pay people in money or in, you know, exposure. Monetization has it comes. You know, Gay Magazine has like 100K. I just felt like it just was, you know, a slap in the face to not, you know, give somebody a reward on the back end, even if it was like $10 or $20. So no Zoom meeting happened with Sydney, with me, you know, no share StreamYard happened. And eventually I resigned from them, and I'm with Trans Griot with an all trans, you know, backing with Encore, Miss Didi Waters, and so on and so forth. So this new trans girl had came out the mix at the newest gay event and started interviewing Kid Ken, and I'm just like, wow. So, you know, someone on, you know, on Facebook was like, they'll literally get someone that's transitioned, you know, early in their, you know, career than, you know, somebody who is more full-fledged. And, you know, I don't want to really kind of take it there, but I felt the same way. Like, why does our representation always have to be trans women who start out early in their transition? And I felt like, you know, I resonated with Akasha with this, and I just didn't understand, like, why Gay Magazine wouldn't kind of give me my moment. But also, it led me to, you know, the moment that I have now, where, you know, I can do whatever I want when it comes to topics, and I don't have to ask anybody anything, and I have my own platform, which is this YouTube channel. So like I said, cisgender men and women, we're not all connected as you think in the community, you know, and united. So a lot of us are divided. I wanted to thank the trans men and women of this channel that, you know, support me, and I just wanted to, you know, just let y'all know that there's a lot of things going on behind the scenes that you probably, you know, would never know when it comes to these blogs like Tens Magazine and Upper Appalachian. But you just have to be careful. Support who you want to support, but remember, you know, your representation matters as well.
On May 17th of 2023. So May 17th, that's literally less than a year ago. And you are now saying that you're trans.
Well, I was going to congratulate her, but I mean, does she have a porn Strawberry Space? Valerie Vision, YouTuber, had called her out. I mean, she had posted up on them. I'm talking about a mandatory meeting. and this is a RuPaul's Drag Race star. But then, you know, we was all happy for her, right, Strawberry Space? So then Valerie had said and called Amanda's transition microwavable when she said, wait, how could you transition and claim that you identify as trans pre-Drag Race, but that you did Drag Race as a cisgender homosexual man? And it started May 2023. So I don't know, girl, the timeline is timelining. I mean, that is very quick. Like, we are just in February of this year. I think a lot of people want, you know, this transition is to go for trans women, like, under the radar. But I mean, if you're transitioning, I do want people to know, cisgender men and women of this channel, like, you do have to start somewhere. So I do want to give Amanda a little bit of grace, because it's just like, okay, if you're in front of this big audience, and you know what I'm saying, you have to start from ground zero. Now, if you say that you were trans all this time and then that you went on TV as one thing, and you know, that's different. But I just feel like, you know, we all have a focal point. I don't know. It's a tough, tricky situation, because it's just like a lot of people just think, okay, I got the wig, I got the makeup, okay, I'm trans. And it's just like, no, you have to go through like a lot with, you know, doctors and hormones and everything. But now that the hormones are so accessible, a lot of people can just be like, okay, now I'm here. We're here now. And it's just like, well, before the generations before us, we had a lot to get here. And now y'all are just giving it to us. So I want to also acknowledge, I think her name is Taya Ashton. She was brutally murdered. This is a trans woman. So we want to just glorify, you know, Miss Amanda and her new transition. But we also want to also put a spotlight on the unexperienced death of the transition and of the difference between a drag queen and a trans woman. So welcome to the party club, Miss Meeting. So speaking of trans woman and drag queen, I thought it would be kind of humorous to end this on some drama, since y'all say Candy is trans, even though we giving she her pronouns to her because she feminally presents, but she keeps saying it's your boy Candy, emphasis on boy Candy. Child, Sasha Santana had some new pictures that was to promote his record Standing on Business. He got a whole Standing on Business rap challenge. It hit the shade room. So Candy had a freestyle saying that the material girl fumbled the bag. And girl, now Candy and Sasha Santana beefing, girl. Can y'all imagine that? Who y'all think will win on a rap battle with that? Like, I don't know. I feel like Saucy just does more catchy shit, but Candy's a lyricist. This is very entertaining. I still want people to understand that Saucy has said in multiple interviews that he is not trans, wanted to transition, but it just didn't align with him. Candy's not trans. And I just want y'all to actually give the credit and the proper identification of trans to the actual transgender woman in question. So, girl, that's all I got. I feel like I've drawn this out long enough. I hope I didn't offend anybody. Like I said, I will be coming up with some tips for trans women in the workplace on my next video. And I hope y'all have a nice day. So, Strawberry Space, that's all I got. If you have any more news and tea, let me know. Bye, Strawberry Space.